Welcome everyone. Welcome to the panel event, most hot topic of the year, like sustainability and blockchain. We have a great lineup of speakers. I'm Sagar Barwalia, head of venture development at BlockRocket. I would like to take this opportunity to speak few words about BlockRocket, what we are doing and what we do. So BlockRocket, in nutshell, BlockRocket is an accelerator program for blockchain-based startups. What we are doing, we do like investment, early stage investment into seed and pre-seed startups. We invest up to €250,000 as a ticket size. Then after the investment, we take them into an acceleration program, which runs for up to like 24 months. In this time frame, our startups receive all kind of advisory, 360 degree advisory, like matchmaking, marketing, and we try to help them to connect with the VCs. We have like 30 plus VCs in our portfolio. They are like our partners. We talk to them like time to time. And very, very important thing, we are like a blockchain agnostic. Apart from that, we also highly focus in German ecosystem. So BlockRocket, in nutshell, we have like, we started like in 2019. In last 2 years, we achieved like 250 plus partners. In our portfolio, we have like average seed, ticket size, like up to 150,000 to €250,000. We invested up to like 5 to 7 startup investment per year. We have like 250 plus partnership. As I said earlier, we have like 30 plus VCs in our network. That means like when our early stage or seed stage startups goes to the next round, they already know some of the VC and they can stay in touch with them, and it helps them to raise the next funding round. As you are aware of that, every month we do like 1 to 2 events. That makes like 25 plus event per year. We also do like a podcast as well as like we do also like monthly pitch events. So in nutshell, as you are aware of that, we look really small and young, but our dreams are high. So you know that Y Combinator, Techstar, and Plug and Play, they are like startup acceleration program, and they incubate like a conventional startups. But our focus is very blockchain agnostic. We focus on blockchain. And apart from that, we are highly German ecosystem based. That means like when the startup is in our program, German ecosystem is our main focus. So how does it work? So basically like we have like a several like a process, several step when the startup is applying for our like acceleration program or investment. So they have to go through the application. They can you can apply on our website. After the application round, there are like a 2-3 interviews. We call for it. Sometimes we also invite them to our events, into our monthly pitch event, if we think like we would like to know more about your startup in details. After several due diligence, we reach to the investment procedure, and this all procedure runs for like 4 to 6 weeks. Of course, this is not a one-man show, so this is the BlockRocket team. We are based in Munich, Berlin, and Frankfurt, as well as we are also backed by like prominent VC from the space, the Blockchain Founders Group. We are in touch with them time to time, and they also help us and train us when it comes to looking for the high-level and quality blockchain-based startups. Let's stay in touch. So if you or your friends or family building something big or next big thing in the blockchain space, and if you are looking for funding, feel free to apply to our program, or you can always reach out to us via LinkedIn or Twitter. Okay, moving further, we have like a 4 prominent blockchain personalities to talk about like sustainability in blockchain. I would like to ask each of them to introduce about yourself for 30 seconds to 1 minute. But before we start, I would like to tell our viewers and our audience, there is like a chat share in the chat box where there is like a WhatsApp, Telegram, and LinkedIn and Twitter link where you can go there and ask your question. I will try to take 2 to 3 questions in between that panel event. Perfect. So far, so good from my side. Then let's start with the ladies. There is already like a woman, already fewer women in the blockchain space. So I would like to welcome Suzanne. Suzanne is a PhD scholar. She is doing her PhD in sustainability in blockchain technology. So Suzanne, please introduce yourself.
Yeah, hi Saga, thank you for having me. Yes, as you said, I'm a PhD fellow at Aalborg University, that is in Northern Denmark, for those of you who don't know that. I'm working on a project called Sustainability of Blockchain Technology, where we mainly look at 2 different parts. So one is I've done also a study on Bitcoin mining and the carbon footprint of mining. And on the other hand, we've looked at blockchain applications in supply chains and how the technology can be used to create positive impact. Yeah, so this is mainly what I've been working on the past years.
Thank you, Suzanne. Moving further, we have Professor Philip Sandner. He was ranked one of the top 30 economics by Frankfurt Allgemeine Zeitung. Allgemeine Zeitung, a major newspaper in Germany. I think I cannot, if I go continuously, then I need like half an hour to introduce himself. But Professor Philip Sandner, stage is yours. Please introduce yourself.
Yes, thanks, Sagar. Happy to be here. Nice that you're putting this topic on the agenda. My name is Philip. I have founded together with the University, of course, the Frankfurt School Blockchain Center, sitting at the Frankfurt School of Finance and Management. The Frankfurt School is a small but agile and speedy university in Frankfurt, focusing primarily on the area of business, management, and finance. And 4 or 5 years ago, we thought that the president thought that we have to focus on blockchain at some point of time because it might be the future of finance. We started alone with me and then soon employed first people, have gotten some grants from institutions, but also did some consulting projects, conferences, and so on. Now we have 10 employees and are operating a couple of very interesting programs. I think the most interesting program we are operating at this point of time is the so-called DLT Talents program. That's a program where we are trying to empower women for the blockchain space. And I think this year we will in total have coached and mentored maybe 200, 250 women for the blockchain space. So it's really growing and increasingly really working. It's working fully remote. In batches, we have 18 weeks of coaching. Women are asked to do some assignments, some homework, and then present it in the next subsequent session. And this mode of coaching and lecturing and mentoring apparently works very well. It's also international. So we have women there from all over the world, from Mexico to Vietnam. And for example, Alexandra, one of the organizers here, has also been in that program. So just to highlight one of the initiatives which we are doing, we have a couple of more, and very soon we are launching DeFi Talents. That's basically exactly the same program, but to identify DeFi talents for computing smart contracts and all kinds of things in the world of decentralized finance.
Thank you, Philip. Once again, thank you for coming here and taking time to speak at our panel event. We are looking forward to have more discussion. Moving further, we have Levin. He is a head of research at Crypto Finance and CTO at Crypto Storage AG. Levin, stage is all yours.
Yep. So Levin Bünke, my background is as a theoretical physicist from high performance computing background, where I'd spent a lot of time at universities, but got involved in interested and had some exposure to crypto assets in 2011, when it was not crypto assets, but crypto asset. And ever since did projects in the surrounding ecosystem. So mining early on when it was possible on a CPU, wrote trading bots, what you would imagine happens in inefficient markets if somebody plays around. I joined Crypto Finance in 2017. Crypto Finance, the group, is focusing on enabling institutional investors, financial institutions, to participate in the blockchain ecosystem, basically in three different ways. We have three operating entities. Crypto Fund we have an asset management arm, which is a FINMA regulated asset manager and building products there that was the first FINMA regulated asset manager. We have a brokerage business, which is also FINMA regulated as a securities house. And I'm then CTO of Crypto Storage, which is an infrastructure technology arm building a storage solution for institutional investors to store crypto assets. And I'm also head of research of the group, overseeing basically internal education, sometimes external, but mostly internal.
Thank you, Levin. Moving further, last but not least, we have Alex. He's a founder at DigiEconomist. I have just put the link in the chat box below, so feel free to check out. And Alex, please introduce yourself.
Yes, I'll keep it a bit short. So the link users forward to DigiEconomist, the website is best known for hosting the Bitcoin Energy Consumption Index since late 2016. And that's been cited a lot around the world when it comes to the energy consumption of the Bitcoin network. And I've also produced several academic papers on this specific topic, and so far unofficially doing a PhD, but hoping to make that official as of next year.
Thank you, Alex. Moving further, let's start the panel event and we can move further. I would like to start with Susanne. Susanne, I was reading today morning Financial Times. In the front page, it says like PwC is ready to hire another 500,000 people in next 5 years. They have like more than 5 billion of budget to hire them, train them. So can you please explain us what is ESG and why is it related to the blockchain? How it can influence blockchain?
You're putting me on the spot here a little bit. So ESG relates to environmental and sustainability within and social governance within companies. And it is important because we are at a point in the world where we have decided as a world to battle not only climate change, but also increase a more equitable society. So within the Paris Agreement, for example, we've agreed that we want to limit the emissions and global warming below 2 degrees and if possible below 1.5 degrees. And for this, every actor needs to do something. So ESG is usually within companies and business models that take action and take responsibility themselves that want to make some changes. So this is important that every actor takes their responsibility and takes actions, and it's not just the government's responsibility, who also play a huge role, but it's, responsibilities of all.
Yes, sorry. Philip, would you like to add some more words on ESG thing?
So I think Susanne is absolutely right. You know, ESGs came up a couple of years ago, and in the beginning, it was just a concept, and now it has been morphed into all-encompassing goal system, which is also applicable for companies, investors, and so on. And you see it, for example, in the financial area, that companies, in case they are investing, for example, Allianz Global Investors, for example, it's a huge investor, that they are trying, if possible, to invest in such companies which to some degree are complying with ESG goals, right? And you now see that basically this has a very important impact because it then affects stock market prices. Companies who are complying with ESG goals potentially have a higher valuation than others. And therefore, companies and the boards of companies to some degree have to comply with what's set out here. And it's varying in a very broad area, right? So of course it's about environmental health, it's about diversity, it's about empowering women, it's about waste. There are tons of ESGs which are all relevant. And very often, that's my personal impression, but please challenge me, very often companies are picking a set of ESGs, and then they are trying to really deliver on a set of ESGs, whether it's diversity or other things, but trying to basically do something in this area. And since it's relevant for the capital market, then that's the idea. It also affects stock prices if it's done credible. And that's basically the vision which is out there, so to really bring people to these ESGs and comply with them. And ultimately, you also see the ECB pushing this topic of sustainability a little bit. This can be challenged because the ECB has the sole mandate to keep prices stable. They do not have the mandate for climate change. Therefore, this can be disputed. But in general, you see a very large movement in all kinds of industries, societies, financial sectors to try to drive these ESGs more forward. Yeah, maybe somebody here in the round can also add some more examples on these ESGs. There are so many various out there.
Levin, would you like to add something?
I don't think I have the particular expertise in ESG when I compare it to these players. What I maybe would like to add is that I believe we will come, I hope we will come back to these topics later. That there that I've experienced that with ESG, there is a bit of what can be measured will be optimized. And there are a few areas where I believe there are environmentally friendly versions of mining, for example, of Bitcoin mining, that might not actually match the requirements of ESG, even though they would be beneficial for compared to the current status quo.
So when it comes to Bitcoin mining, then my next question to the Alex is, what is your opinion between proof of work and proof of stake? Do you think the Bitcoin should move to proof of stake?
You know, this is actually a question that you can talk for hours about, because it's a very broad question that goes beyond the environmental impact of these systems. But when we talk about proof of stake versus proof of work, people tend to focus on the environmental aspect, because proof of work is very well known for, you know, the energy consumption related to the Bitcoin network that's running on proof of work. And if you were to migrate from such a proof of work system to a proof of stake based system, you can reduce the energy consumption of such a network by 99.95%. So in terms of environment, that is a really clear win. Proof of stake doesn't have any special incentive to use energy consuming hardware. But then the thing is, it's not just about energy consumption. Ultimately, these protocols provide security to the network, and people will say, well, the reason we don't want to move to proof of stake is because proof of work is more robust. And then if you're going to dissect that, it becomes a really complicated discussion, because what makes a robust network in proof of stake, if you own a majority of the wealth, then you are capable of attacking the network. If you in Bitcoin own a majority of the computational power, you're capable of attacking the network. And what is then the most robust network? It's extremely complicated. What I can say is that proof of work isn't perfect by itself in terms of robustness, because we've seen historically a lot of this computational power gathering in a single country. Now that's changing. Now that China is banning Bitcoin, but this is something that has happened in the past. We have seen mining pool oligarchies. We have seen that a single producer manufacturer can dominate the hardware market. And just a few years ago, they put a backdoor in their equipment. So you have to consider all this. And if you're moving to proof of stake, it has its own security profile, and it's just not something you can't just compare it very easily. But at least in terms of environmental impact, proof of stake would be a very big improvement over proof of work, because like I said, there is no incentive to use energy consuming hardware. But I think it's good to remind people that there's more trade-offs than just that one.
Thank you, Alex. Before we move into like detailed discussion about energy consumption and proof of work and proof of stake, I would like to ask Philip, can you please explain why blockchain is superior when it comes to trust, immutability, transparency, lower cost, smart contracts, and traceability?
Yeah, that's also a very huge question. So I think you always have to differentiate between the public blockchain networks and the permission blockchain network. That's an old discussion. You know, this has been pretty boring already. People discussing it since a couple of years. But in fact, you know, in case we are now watching all these networks now in 2021, we have to admit that the only blockchain systems which are really working at scale are the decentralized networks, Bitcoin, Ethereum, and a couple of others. The promise of enterprise blockchain networks has not been fulfilled. We have had so many examples, projects, ideas, working papers out there since a couple of years, but these systems, they are growing. Yes, they are growing, but at a much slower speed in comparison to decentralized protocols in the form of Bitcoin, Ethereum, and so on. I think that's a fact, because it's just the numbers when you look at the transaction volume on public blockchain systems or decentralized protocols. So what can you do with it? I think you have all kinds of types out there, but let's quite quickly compare Bitcoin. Bitcoin is technically absolutely brilliant, but from a functionality, quite boring. Yeah, Bitcoin does what it does. That's basically what people in the Bitcoin ecosystem typically say. People, you can't program too much, but Bitcoin just works and it does what it does. And that's happening since 11 years, right? And why do you need Bitcoin? Because without anybody stopping me, I can own, transport, and transfer Bitcoins around the entire world, and nobody can stop me. Over here in Germany, where we have quite good institutions, this is not necessarily needed because we have quite good banks, you know, they are also capable of keeping my money. But in case I would live in South America, East Asia, or in other countries, then I might see the benefit of Bitcoin because I would then be able to hold value, transport it, transfer it without anybody who could interrupt me. And in case I would live in a country with inflation, yeah, Turkey and other countries where it's even more severe, Nigeria and so on, then sometimes Bitcoin can be said to be the last resort of financial sovereignty, right? It's just applying to a couple of people out there on the planet, but I think that this movement is getting bigger and bigger. We now see this in El Salvador. And one sentence about Ethereum as an entirely different aspect. Ethereum can be said to be some kind of international asset management platform where you can deploy all kinds of assets on top of Ethereum. You can deploy dollar, stocks, securities. You can deploy all kinds of things on top of Ethereum. Like an iPhone is having an app store with thousands of apps, you can also deploy tokens on Ethereum and you can move them around within 20 seconds around the entire world. So I can take US dollar and move it from here in Cologne where I'm sitting over to South Korea and the US dollar, 20 US dollar, something like this, will arrive within 20 seconds. You know, this is really massive because it's point to point, it's peer to peer, point to point, it's working without any intermediary. So you see here, both Bitcoin and Ethereum do make sense. They have system immanent currencies, that's Bitcoin and Ether. And along with Bitcoin and Ethereum, you have many other smart contract platforms and so on, which also are here and there quite interesting and partly also growing significantly.
Thank you, Philip. I think Levin, Philip talk about like a transaction getting or like increasing day by day, right? And there are like a big misconceptions that more adoption and more transaction will cause more energy consumption. What are your thoughts on it?
That's true. Maybe to preface a lot of what I think I will say today is that I totally agree that Bitcoin's electricity consumption is like off the charts as it is today. But I believe that a big part of that is that the network incentives are currently extremely skewed due to the very high mining subsidy, like the block reward of newly minted coins. So I think it's worthwhile to look at try to have a bit of a view of how does the electricity consumption change in 10, 20, 50 years? How does it change once the subsidy goes down, like at halves every 4 years? It's currently at 6.25 Bitcoin. I looked at through a few blocks today. The reward that miners get from fees for actually fulfilling the duty of like producing blocks is maybe about 10% of these 6.25 Bitcoin. So 90% roughly, rounding furiously here, 90% is a subsidy which is going down and goes away. So I think it's worthwhile to have a look at how is the electricity consumption probably going to change as the network grows and as the subsidy goes down. And for that, I think the most like misleading number that is very often quoted when it comes to looking at the energy footprint of Bitcoin is looking at something like how much electricity do we spend per transaction? Because if you do that, then that somewhat suggests that as adoption grows, as more transaction happens, as more participants come on board, that the electricity consumption of Bitcoin, like per transaction, is going to stay about that, and the total amount consumed is going through the roof. And that's like not at all the case. Right? The miners will always essentially work at marginal profit. So whatever they get in rewards for fulfilling their duty, they will spend most of the money, most of that income on electricity, on operations, on mining hardware, so that they still make a profit. If somebody else is willing to do it as less marginal profit, then he will jump in and take over that role. So I think that's important. And I would like to differentiate between also two things that are also kind of part of this how does it scale? Plus another argument that often comes up is, well, if the price of Bitcoin doubles, what does the electricity consumption do then? Will we have double as much mining because the reward is doubling in a sense? And the answer to that is the same as essentially today, yes. Today, if the price of Bitcoin is doubling, yes, because the subsidy is like an amount that is fixed in Bitcoin. It's going down over time, but today it's fixed in Bitcoin. And if the price of Bitcoin doubles, there is double the reward. There will be, like, over time, obviously it's not flipping a switch from one day to the other. But over time, the amount of electricity spent will also double correspondingly. But that's not true for the fees that people pay, right? For the fee part of the mining reward, that's not true, because there the economic consideration is a different one. I, as a user of the network, I have to consider is what am I willing to pay for the security that I get from the network that executes my transaction. And that's a consideration that in my head I make, like, in real world value. I don't want to say in US dollar or in Swiss francs, but that I make, like, in value, not in Bitcoin. So that part, the fee part, that does not scale up as the Bitcoin price rises. That stays more or less the same. It's just the reward part. And again, the reward is currently above about 90% of the total reward that miners make, which is completely off the charts. And I would be very glad if it would be possible to flip a switch and get that down to essentially zero, but we can't. We have to go through a few more halvings before that's the case. And I think by then the mining economics will be very different from what it is today.
Thank you, Levin. Moving further, I would like to ask Suzanne, this question is for you. As per the United Nations Climate Change Conference, experts have noticed that new technology like blockchain could play a significant role in balancing climate change. On the other hand, mainstream media talking about Bitcoin and its energy consumption. What is your reaction? I mean, flying for the tourism is also harmful for the climate, right? But people doesn't stop traveling via airplane or any other mode of transportation. Why everyone is targeting blockchain?
Yeah, I think when you mentioned flying, this is something completely different. That's not even slightly comparable. I want to actually first address something that Levin just said and then come back to your question, because I think, like you said, we agree that currently the energy consumption is off the charts. And you said that if when the mining reward decreases over time, the energy consumption will not increase because the transaction costs stay more stable. They don't increase as much, or they don't increase the income of the miners as much. I would actually argue we hope that this is true, but I think it's so difficult to predict the system. We currently don't know how it will develop over the next 2 years. We don't know how it will develop over the next 30 years. There are many uncertainties. If you were to look back from now to 2008, the Bitcoin price has increased more than I think to make up this difference. And this may very well switch. We don't know. I mean, this could be the case, but we just don't know. So I think it depends on so many things, like how will scalability of more transactions be addressed and so on. But I think it's, we hope for this, but I think it's not necessarily going to happen. We just don't really know.
Maybe address just yeah. One sentence there. I totally agree. And whatever we can do as, like, quick measures to address the problem, I mean, totally with that. I just want to frame the discussion more in a bit that like we need to address the short-term problem. The long-term problem is a very different one than what we have in the short-term problem.
Yeah, and I think maybe from the research perspective, I think what is lacking right now and what we need to focus on is also understanding short-term changes, so that then we are maybe better at making these long-term predictions, because right now we are not able to do this.
I can make a long-term prediction if you wish.
Sure.
I think it's very speculative, and you never know what happens. But I think the system works as follows: take the number of bitcoins which are generated day by day. That's 900. And then you multiply it with the current price of Bitcoin, which is 40,000. So you take this amount of money, and theoretically, that's exactly the amount of money you would be willing to invest in producing these Bitcoins. And the money for producing Bitcoins goes primarily in energy and partly also in computer processors. That's the mining chips and so on. So what happens?
It's not a long-term prediction, though, right? That's the short-term prediction.
I know, but I first need to create some baseline model. So what happens then? I think we are running into a phase of inflation. This will drive the euro and fiat currencies in a way that they are getting a little bit weaker in comparison to the past. So in terms of the Bitcoin price models out there, you could argue that the degree of hardness, yeah, so the stock to flow metric of fiat money is going down. And then it gets exciting because the stock to flow model, so the degree of how hard Bitcoin is and gold is at this point of time around 60, and this number would go down for the euro and for the US dollar. So potentially it could be possible that people are then here and there switching towards harder assets. This means that they are exchanging the euro into harder assets that could be Bitcoin, gold, stocks, real estate, and so on. This would then drive the price up. And then in line with the formula, which we just have discussed, the budget, which is available on a daily level for investing it into hardware and energy, is then increasing. So this way, the energy consumption would increase. Then you have halvening coming up in 3 years and another halvening in 7 years and so on. This would drive the number of Bitcoins generated per day down. So then theoretically the energy consumption will shrink. So you have two counter passing effects. You have the price development, which should increase the energy consumption, and you have the halvening, which should decrease it. In total, I would say that the electricity consumption should increase. The question now, is it good or bad? Bitcoin is always trying to exploit those energy resources which are most cost efficient. And it's a fact that the most cost efficient energy sources at this point of time are hydropower, solar power, and so on. And therefore, I think that we in the future could imagine that Bitcoin is getting greener as of now, but it's a long-term effect, right? It's not happening on a short term, but it could happen within the next 5 or 6 years that Bitcoin is getting a little bit greener than today. And therefore, I think what we will see, I think we will have an increasing electricity consumption, but I also could imagine that the share of green electricity being consumed by the Bitcoin network is also increasing. That would be my prediction. I don't know if you would like to reject it, but that's something I could imagine which could happen.
Thank you, Philip. Do you agree with this, the slide I shared? The Bitcoin energy mining consumption, like energy consumption with renewable sources and like a normal electricity.
Yeah, I would not doubt these numbers. It seems intuitively, it seems quite okay. Like it's the big centers it's the number of miners that try to go green is high, but it's the biggest ones that don't. That makes absolutely sense.
Okay, then my next question comes to Alex. Alex, as per Michel Saylor, I think everyone knows who is Michel Saylor. He said that in one of his interview that USA produce 160,000 terawatt per hour a year. Out of that, 50,000 terawatt per hour is getting wasted. And quarter of that wasted energy, Bitcoin consumes for the mining. Are you agree with this?
Well, Michael Saylor, maybe a number magician. What I know is that in the world, according to the International Energy Energy Agency, we are consuming around 24,000 terawatt hours of electrical energy per year. So maybe Michael Saylor is adding up all kinds of energy sources, but when it comes to energy, or specifically electrical energy, it's just 24,000 terawatt hours per year. It's not like we're pouring gasoline into these Bitcoin miners. So, and if we look at the Bitcoin network, we then see that this network is consuming around 120 terawatt hours of electrical energy per year, which would make for 0.5% of our total global electrical energy consumption. People will then wonder, is that a lot or is that a little? First of all, let's consider that 0.5%, there is probably things out there that use more energy than Bitcoin, but it's not a negligible number. It's more than half of what we are consuming for all of our data centers worldwide. And if you've seen the messages in the news recently, we already think that is a problem. So it probably depends on your perspective. Same is true for the carbon footprint associated with this, the Bitcoin network. If you take those fossil versus renewable estimates we have and come up with a carbon estimate for this network, it comes down to around 60 million metric tons of carbon per year, which is versus our total global emissions of around 33 billion metric tons of carbon per year, just 0.20%. Again, there will be bigger causes of emissions. I was recently doing something with the fashion industry, and I know the fashion industry is definitely taking a bigger percentage than Bitcoin. But at the same time, you have to also put it into another perspective, which is that governments around the world over the past years have spent billions, for example, on electric vehicles, and now realize that, this Bitcoin network is responsible for more carbon emissions than we are saving in total from deploying electric vehicles around the world. So it's a matter of perspective, but especially the last one has gotten a lot of politicians quite angry recently. So yeah, you could say it's a lot because of that, or at least the Bitcoin will probably feel the adverse regulations at some point as a result of this. And I don't think we should be looking for excuses in the sense of there's other things that use more energy. We really need to look at, what are we using all that energy for in Bitcoin itself? And the reality is that Bitcoin is very limited because it doesn't just have this huge energy consumption associated with it, but it also has a scalability problem. It doesn't scale. It can handle 7 transactions per second, whereas if you have a payment provider like Visa, they can do 65,000 transactions per second if needed. So, there is just not a whole lot of ways you can use the Bitcoin network. If people start to use the Bitcoin network, it gets congested, fees go up, you quickly have to pay over $50 on average just to make a transaction happen very recently. And that's just reducing the usefulness of the entire system. It's effectively reducing the amount of use cases to being just speculating in it, because if you're trying to use it for payments, it's going to be too costly, too slow, and it's not going to work out. And that's where it starts to become problematic, because then you have 0.5% of our global electricity consumption for something that you can't really use for anything else than speculation at the moment. And you can debate on what is the right way to look at this. Levin mentioned the carbon footprint per transaction metric. I think it's important to keep in mind that carbon footprints should be seen as a sort of measure of efficiency. So
absolutely, but not per transaction. That's the dishonest part. So to look, have a look at the carbon footprint, absolutely, I'm with you there.
Well, on a transaction level, it's a valid measure, because if there is no transaction without spending that energy. If you are making a Bitcoin transaction, it has to be processed in a block, and there are no new blocks without the energy consumed for creating those blocks.
Yeah, so that doesn't make much sense, to be honest. This really doesn't make sense, because you have to look at the money which is transacted in a block, not necessarily the transactions. Look at PayPal. PayPal is having, millions or hundred thousands of people who potentially could own Bitcoin. At the end of the day, inside the Bitcoin, it might just be one single transaction per day, but it's hundreds of people, millions of euro being transacted. I think the better measure is the electricity being consumed per transacted million, for example. And here I would still argue that Bitcoin is worse than legacy systems, right? But I could imagine that in the future, the transaction volume is going up. You will have low value transaction being offloaded to other networks. You see this already happening, for example, in Ethereum, where low value transactions are being offloaded into other systems. And the high secure Ethereum Matter chain and Bitcoin chain are simply carrying the high value transactions, which are requiring a very high degree of security. And then it makes sense to measure the transaction volume and the comparable energy consumption, but it doesn't make sense to measure the electricity being consumed per transaction.
And then just pushing, I'm not going to talk too much about it, but just putting a lightning as a word out here, I think that's relevant at this point. I would like to challenge your numbers a bit, and please don't get that wrong, because I'm not being apologetic. The energy consumption is too big, but I'm still somewhat allergic to wrong comparisons and to wrong numbers. Let me just read you one sentence from a Morgan Stanley research report that they published on 11th, I believe that was last Friday, where they said Bitcoin uses 0.5% of all global energy consumption, the equivalent of what a small country like the Netherlands consumes. And they do quote your website on that, right? That's where they get the number, and you quoted a similar number right now. I went to your website and you do it right. You also did it right here. But the statement of Morgan Stanley, that's wrong. And I think they got it wrong by a factor of 8, essentially. Because what they write is they compare the energy consumption of Bitcoin to the energy consumption of the Netherlands. That's not correct. the Bitcoin only has, what they do is they compare the electricity consumption of Bitcoin to the electricity consumption of the Netherlands. That's about the same, but Bitcoin only uses electricity. And the Netherlands uses about 1/8 of their total energy consumption is electricity. So if you want an honest energy to energy comparison, then Bitcoin would be like at North Korea level and not at Netherlands level. Still too high. I don't argue with that at all. And I think I gave arguments why I think it will go down on its own, and we will probably come to what are good sources of energy for Bitcoin mining in a second, or I hope we will come there. But just saying that the numbers that are being quoted based on the numbers that you publish are just off typically by a factor of 7 or 8.
Understood. So Levin, you are saying like, Bitcoin mining energy consumption should not be compared with any GDP, any small country or like any economy, because that's not relevant, right? I mean, in your term.
Not really. Of course, you can always compare numbers. I think we very quickly go into areas of whataboutism there. I can give you a whole list of things that I think should not exist and spend a lot more, too much electricity, too much energy. I don't think that golf courses should be a thing, right? But do I use that to make an argument about energy consumption of golf courses versus Bitcoin? I think at the end of the day, yes, we have to respond to honest comparison. I would like these comparisons to be honest and not claiming like energy consumption of Netherlands, but in fact using the number for electricity consumption of Netherlands. But yeah, I mean, the bottom line is, and I think that nobody disagrees on that, the electricity consumption is too high.
Understood. Moving further, my next question to you, Philip, is what is yours? I mean, everyone knows that there is next month EIP 1255. There's like consensus going on, and Ethereum is moving from proof of work to proof of stake, right? So that's called like ETH 2.0. What do you think, will Ethereum succeed in terms of like from moving from proof of work to proof of stake?
Yeah, that's an interesting question, because apparently Ethereum has some kind of roadmap towards a new version. It's a major update, which is taking 2 years in total. And two things which are interesting here, you see that Bitcoin is actually capable of doing Ethereum. Ethereum is capable of executing updates on the longer term, but even then it takes years to implement them. With Bitcoin, you have a more tedious system in case you would like to have more smaller updates, then they easily take 4 years, as we have seen it now. So I would doubt that Bitcoin ever moves away from proof of work, because people active in this ecosystem, the miners and so on, they would not bring their ecosystem at risk. So therefore, I do not see that a major update going away from proof of work would actually be executed. And Ethereum somehow has done it, that they have found a solution to upgrade or to move away. Upgrade is the wrong word because it adds a valuation here, but to move from proof of work towards proof of state, a proof of stake with a K, sorry. And I think this is interesting because with this, we see some kind of roadmap for Ethereum for getting green and potentially more sustainable. And in case the public and also companies and investors are interested in ESGs and sustainable investing, then they would rather choose Ethereum over Bitcoin. And this, and once again, I do not doubt that Bitcoin will not stay the number one cryptocurrency out there. I think this remains as it is right now, but I could imagine that the gap between Ethereum and Bitcoin could become closer because of institutional money, which can more easily flow into Ethereum, and investors have difficulties investing in Bitcoin because of the energy footprint. That's my opinion, but you know, that's a trial to look into the future. It can also be entirely different.
Thank you, Philip. Moving further, Susanne, this question is for you. What are the major opportunities of using blockchain technology to foster sustainability?
Yeah, moving to a different topic. Actually, first, I want to look at something else. Can you pull up the chart again that you had about renewable energies?
Sure.
The very first one. Because, the previous one, yeah.
No, this one, right?
I was a little bit confused because I think you have to, so the second one is also share of energy consumption of mining and not of total mining, because I was looking at it and then saw the left one was like 76% use some kind of renewable energies, but on the right it says that 39% is the entire renewable energy share of mining. And I was a little bit confused by that when I was looking at it earlier, but yeah, just wanted to make sure I got it correctly and say correctly. Yeah, so to move to the question you had, so what are the opportunities of using blockchain technology to create sustainability? And maybe also what you asked earlier, I think that you had this comment of the UN Climate Change Conference that says they see blockchain as a potential tool to balance climate change and govern climate change. And on the other hand, you have this discussion about Bitcoin. The main point is that they are talking about blockchain, but they're not talking about necessarily the same thing, because Bitcoin is one blockchain. There are many more possibilities of how blockchain can be implemented. The words cannot be used interchangeably as sometimes in the discussion. And that's, I think, just one of the main points. Where I think there are main potentials are, and I mean, there are different potentials. I think one of the main points is in financial inclusion, something that is maturing over the past years. So there are still an estimated 2 billion people that are unbanked, that don't have access to bank accounts, to access to credit cards and insurance. And using blockchain technology can create potentials or in automation, disintermediation, reducing the costs and having a secure solution. So people in remote areas can get access to banking. They can have access, remittances can become a lot cheaper. Transaction can be faster. So I think for unbanked people in this world to gain access to financial services is a huge step. This is, I think, one of the first and most significant points. And the second point that I want to highlight, because there are many more potentials, is something that is more early on, I think, is tokenizing for sustainability. I think there is the option to incentivize specific behavior. This can be used in any way, but it couldn't be used for sustainability as well. So implementing systems where having renewable, using renewable energy is additionally tokenized or is incentivized through this. As a brand, incentivizing your suppliers to take certain measures which they can choose from could be incentivized. Maybe they get better conditions if they do something like this. So I think, I'm not sure if these were the best examples, but the point is there's room for creativity for using these tools for governing this to create sustainability and use blockchain technology as sustainability. And at the same time, I think it's also important to continuously measure the success of these tools, because your incentive is great and will foster sustainability, but you need to make sure that it really does and overcome barriers that are there with any kind of technology. But I think these are maybe two opportunities that could be highlighted.
Thank you, Suzanne. I think we are running out of time, so please try to speak in short. Moving further, my next question to Philip is from Suzanne, talk about tokenization. I think you are, like Philip, pushing a lot in terms of like CBDC, digital euro and tokenization. How tokenization or like a digital euro can help us reduce carbon footprint?
Well, you first have to decide on what kind of platform you're running this, right? In case you're running this on Ethereum, then right now the euro also has a bad footprint. That's the same with the USDT and USDC projects, right? But once Ethereum is moving away towards proof of stake, then the US dollar on Ethereum would be quite efficient, right? I like the use cases which Susanne has pointed out, but we also have to be very honest here. Enterprise solutions have overpromised and not much has happened with regard to permissioned blockchains ran by consortia out there who promised us all kinds of networks and all kinds of things. Not much has happened here. The only systems which are really transacting value day by day is Bitcoin, Ethereum, and the other ones. All other projects are here and there creating some kind of steps forward, but still they overpromised. That's I think what we really have to mention here. And therefore, I do not really think that permission systems or consortium blockchain will really hold what they have promised, but I would rather argue that Ethereum as an universal transaction layer, similarly like Cardano and other ones, potentially could also implement such use cases as Susanne has pointed out. And interestingly, we will also see what El Salvador will be happening. You know, in El Salvador, you have a lot of people who are financially excluded. And once Bitcoin and Lightning is being brought there, it could be that it will be Bitcoin, which is financially including people over there, right? It could be possible. We have to see it, right? But besides this, talking again about Ethereum, I think it makes sense to do such use cases on Ethereum. And one of the most interesting use cases, which has not been mentioned so far, is the tokenization of CO2 certificates on Ethereum, right? So you could organize systems where you can see the provenance of CO2 certificates, which could then be sold to companies. That's exactly how Elon Musk has created quite some wealth with regard to Tesla by being energy efficient and selling these CO2 certificates to others. And that's basically at this point of time a quite manual business. It would make very much sense to bring this on a worldwide ledger to allow CO2 certificates to be traded.
Thank you, Philip. Moving further, Alex, this question is for you. Do you think Bitcoin energy consumption is a threat to the planet? What is the risk versus reward ratio?
Well, it's a threat to the planet, and I think first of all to Bitcoin itself at the moment, because what we see is that governments, they first of all want to meet their climate goals, second of all they want to keep the lights on for their citizens, and we have now seen several cases where Bitcoin miners have overwhelmed certain local grids because they all come to similar head, they all want to get the same cheap sources of electricity, and because of that they have overwhelmed for example, the local grid in Abkhazia, they have overwhelmed the grid in Iran, causing blackouts. And secondly, we've also seen several cases of Bitcoin miners, particularly in China, reviving idle coal plants, which also involved a series of deadly incidents, which was one of the reasons why China has now banned Bitcoin mining. Governments look at this system and they see, okay, we see blackouts, we see our grid being overwhelmed, we see fossil fuels that we need to leave in the ground being dug up again, and that adds up together, and at some point, like in China, they're just going to outright ban Bitcoin mining. And this is going to quickly snowball out of control for the Bitcoin network, because now China has banned Bitcoin mining. We have to consider China as the world's largest energy market. Miners are now trying to relocate a country like the Netherlands in terms of electricity consumption to elsewhere in the world, but all other grids are a lot smaller, which increases the chances that those grids get overwhelmed and that governments will knee-jerk into regulation against Bitcoin and against Bitcoin mining. And if I know one thing, it's that knee-jerk reactions tend to be bad. So this energy consumption problem is definitely going to be an issue for Bitcoin from an adverse policy perspective. Is it going to be bad for the planet? Well, you know, like I said earlier, in terms of total emissions, we're talking around 0.20% at the moment. So you could say at the moment, it's not going to make the difference in meeting our climate goals. So that's why I'm saying this is definitely a bigger threat to Bitcoin itself at the moment. And if this were to somehow be able to continue to grow, yes, then it could become a threat to the planet itself. But I think, as we are also establishing, governments are already taking actions, and the bigger the impact is, the more action we can expect governments to take. So for me, the primary threat is really for Bitcoin itself at the moment.
Levin, would you like to counter argument of Alex, and then we can take also later on one more question from audience? So please make it short.
I try to make it short. So first, I would absolutely agree. The current energy consumption is off the charts because it's so heavily subsidized. Maybe a different emission schedule would have been better, but then too early on there would have been too much emission. Like, these are economic arguments versus environmental arguments, and nobody really knew in the beginning what the perfect emission schedule would be. Let's go 20 years ahead when Bitcoin is really, when not, hardly any new Bitcoin are mined, when really the majority is just that. And when a mining competition is much, much, much fiercer than it is today. Because I strongly believe that when we are in such an environment, and I try to make it short, but I have to get one example. I have dogs. So what do I do to feed the dogs? I can either just go the environmentally, the obviously environmentally friendly way, go to the butcher and buy organically grown pork filet. That's one option. That's the option that would get the ESG stamp of approval, even though it's probably a bad idea. The other one is I get them industrially produced tinned food, which has way too many antibiotics, is very environmentally unfriendly, and it's probably also a very bad idea. If I think longer about it and think, okay, if I have a very, very strong price competition, if I really look for the cheapest option, if I look for the cheapest, for the option where the profit goes, where the mountain goes to the profit and not the profit to the mountain, where I really am willing to go the extra mile to just save a bit. Then what I do is I go to a big butcher's market and go to the butchers there and ask them for the leftovers, like for chaps or for like the new, I think it's called in English, Schlund. I get that and I give that to my dogs. Like, and that's both the cheapest option and environmentally friendly, because I'm literally using waste. If you do that, there's this nice scene in Back to the Future at the very end of episode one and repeated in episode two, where Doc Brown comes back from the future with his flying car he opens the car and puts like banana peels in that car as fuel. If you watch that and you stop to ask, is that an organically grown banana that he uses as fuel? You're really not getting the point of that. Like, using waste is the cheapest option. And I think I have to emphasize that so much because the stronger the competition goes, the more important is it to find sources of electricity where Bitcoin does not have competition, where Bitcoin mining is literally the only thing that can happen with that electricity, because only that electricity will be the cheapest. And Bitcoin has extremely different infrastructure requirements than any other industry that you can imagine. You can literally, those are like economic, commercially available containers. Upstream produces some under the name Ohm, that you basically need to get that container into a remote location. You don't need streets, you don't need barracks. You just need that container close to an energy source, and you need a satellite uplink with very low speed. That's all you need for Bitcoin mining. And I'm pretty sure that that with the reduced requirements, with the reduced money that will be rewarded to Bitcoin miners, with the lowering subsidies and like waste energy sources, that's the market that you need. And for that, we need a very fierce market, and we need the subsidies to go down. And then I agree, midterm, we have a big problem. Long-term, I'm pretty relaxed.
Thank you, Levin. I think we need to organize this kind of like 3 to 4 more panels to discuss like in fully and to like educate our community. But thanks a lot. I would like to thank all of you to taking your time and joining us today on our panel event on sustainability in blockchain. Unfortunately, we are running out of time. I already took 2 minutes. So once again, thank you all of you. I would like to thank our media event partner Disrupt Network, media partner Bein Crypto and BTC Eco for your support and marketing. Please don't forget to register for our next monthly pitch event. There is a link in chat box below. So looking forward to the next panel event next month. We will come up with like a really good topic and good speakers. Till then, you can follow us on Twitter, LinkedIn, or you can also join our WhatsApp group or Telegram group, and feel free to reach out to us on www.blockrocket.io. Thank you, all of you. Thank you once again. Have a nice evening. Bye-bye.